Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Painter of the Damned by Rob Samborn, narrated by Zac Aleman.
Of time, I have wondered, when the sands fall without a sound, how do the blind know when time is done?
Isabella Scalfini, 1 week before her trial, 1589.
I paint because the spirits whisper madly inside my head.
El Greco, circa 1595. To allow evil to walk the earth sets evil onto oneself. Decree number 3, Ancient Order of the Seventh Sun. 1589 AD, Republic of Venice. The blade grazed Angelo Mascari's cheek, missed only by the turn of his head, followed by a lunge to the chest. The whip snake lashed a lightning-fast double tap. Angelo parried at the last second. His opponent pranced back on the platform and stared him down on guard, the tip of his sword trained on Angelo's throat. Swiping the face was forbidden in this demonstration, but neither the judge nor Angelo's master Fabris called it out. Despite the friendly nature of the bout, death seemed but moments away. The crowd clamored for more. Never had Angelo dueled before such an audience. Spectators filled Piazza San Marco to the edges of the Palazzo Ducale, the Basilica, and the Arcades. He raised his rapier in defense. Exhalations skated across the polished steel in heated cloudbursts. The whip snake's epithet suited him not only for his speed, but also for his physique. Lithe and reed thin, taller and skinnier than Angelo, Rocco Bonetti, the name his mother surely preferred, grinned, knowing the potentially lethal move was illegal. Angelo had thought the moniker pompous before the bout, but now found it accurate. Deadly accurate. Spectators shouted for Angelo's defeat, an outcome that seemed more inevitable with every passing second. 10 minutes prior, he was supremely confident. It was by luck or defensive maneuvers that it hadn't ended already. He felt his tanned complexion reddening beneath the late spring Mediterranean sun. Beads of sweat rolled from his wavy, dark locks, threatening to land in his eyes. But averting his focus for even a half second to wipe his brow would lead to an embarrassing loss, if not the end of his career. Or worse. The snake shuffled his feet and tapped the platform with his rapier. Angelo jumped back, poised to protect himself. Laughter erupted from the piazza. The whip snake's body vacillated in a hypnotic rhythm, his face breaking into a sharp smirk. At 21, a single year older than Angelo, his opponent knew how to milk his moment, giving the audience the entertainment they desired. That he toyed with Angelo in front of the most eminent people in Venice, including the Doge, the leader of the Republic, fueled white heat within. He'd have words with this so-called reptile, assuming the man didn't perform another prohibited move and kill him. It seemed all of Venice watched. As a rising fencing star, he'd been selected to participate in an exhibition with the whip snake, who hailed from a rival academy. Angelo was flattered he'd been chosen as the top bill from Master Fabris's school. A victory could lead to a sponsorship from Renzo Scalfini, which was crucial to lighten Angelo's burdens. He owed too many debts to too many people, all of whom watched the contest from the jubilant crowd. Yet despite the promise of laurels and coin, Angelo only cared about impressing one spectator, Isabella Scalfini, Renzo's wife. He would not disappoint her. True to his name, the whipsnake swayed side to side in his trademark stance. He swiped the air with his rapier, as if severing the head of an invisible foe kneeling before him. Angelo stood stock still, following Master Fabris's instruction.
"Patience for the right moment is a thing of beauty," he'd say.
Beauty. Isabella. Though Angelo couldn't see her, he felt her eyes removing his doublet, shirt, and pantaloons, as she'd done less than 24 hours prior. The warmth from her lips remained on his inner thigh. The taste of her body lingered on his tongue. He craved more. The whip snake struck, as if sensing his opponent's internal distraction. Angelo parried and stumbled backward, nearly slipping off the platform. Spectators exploded with cheers. Even in a friendly bout with no purse, they hungered for blood. Recovering his footing, Angelo shook his head and forced his brain to concentrate. How to beat a snake, particularly such a quick one? A child of an island city, he had little experience with the creatures. A friend once captured a serpent on the mainland. When the boy removed it from the box, he'd held it by the neck, but going for the whip snake's neck was an illegal move. Then again, the judge said nothing upon his opponent's cheek strike. Surprise made a snake more lethal, but snakes could be trampled, especially if surprised. Without another thought, Angelo charged. He hacked relentlessly, startling the whip snake. Metal struck metal, clanging as Angelo's opponent parried and retreated down the platform. And then Angelo took a risk. He aimed for Bonetti's neck, but without intent to strike. As anticipated, Bonetti postured for defense. Switching to a more elegant form, Angelo flicked his wrist and struck Bonetti's breastplate. The whip snake's jaw popped open, stunned. Angelo, too, was momentarily dazed by his victory. When realization set in, he launched his fists into the air with a triumphant grunt and paraded the length of the platform to face the spectators on both sides. Though not one to gloat, he reveled in the adoration from a crowd that longed for his death moments earlier. The whole of the festival applauded as he stepped off the platform. The prettiest girls in Venice rushed over, congratulating him and clasping his muscles. Maidens batted their eyelashes and shielded their blushes with folding fans. He enjoyed the attention, but scanned for his beloved in the massive crowd. Every Venetian agreed this year's Festa della Senza had been the most glorious in memory. In the symbolic ceremony of Venice's marriage to the sea, Doge Cigogna had lobbed a golden ring into the Venetian lagoon as 1,000 boats donned with flags of La Serenissima's coat of arms entered the Grand Canal. A parade of red and yellow flags bearing St. Mark's winged lion cemented the Serene Republic's position as the greatest naval power in the world. Partly a celebration of the successful conversion of the Rialto Bridge from wood to stone, each vessel passed beneath the structure to cheers. Festivities had continued that afternoon in a feast for the senses, as the Duke graced his citizens with the commencement of a week-long jubilee in Piazza San Marco, showcasing song, dance, and theater, as well as feats of strength, dexterity, and gallantry on the horse. The celebration culminated with the main event, Prowess of the Blade. A slap to the back of his head cut Angelo's search short. He turned to find Master Fabris staring down at him, his crimson and gold flat cap angled to the side. The fencing legend, with his curly gray hair and long mustache, was half a head taller than Angelo. His perfect posture made him seem like Mars himself, and is eternally angry.
"I didn't teach you to hack away like a Turkish street rat," Fabris said.
"Apologies, Master Fabris, but
you embarrass me in plain view of the entire city. They'll think I instruct my students to cower in fear and then flail wildly without a strategy or plan."
"But Master, that was my strategy."
Fabris narrowed one eye and raised the brow over his other.
"Snakes can only be defeated at the neck, or crushed altogether."
Fabris relaxed his face and offered the slightest of smiles.
"Rocco Bonetti is not a real snake."
"No, but the move brought a victory to your illustrious school."
If Master Fabris meant to offer his agreement or compliment, Angela would never know, for Fabris received a pat on the back.
"Well done, Fabris," said the short blonde man with a long goatee. "You performed with purpose."
He shook hands with Fabris, who nodded his thanks. Angelo assumed the stranger was Nicoletto Giganti, master of the rival school, for beside him, with his head hung low, stood Angelo's recently deposed opponent. Giganti's fitted turquoise velvet waistcoat matched his beret adorned with an ostrich plume, which Angelo had thought fell out of fashion some years prior.
"We had wondered what strategy you'd use to best the best. It was the whipsnake's first defeat."
Giganti extended his hand.
"Well played, indeed, Mascari."
"Grazie, signor,"
Angelo replied, giving the man a vigorous handshake. Fabris tipped his head to Giganti, before Giganti nudged Rocco,
Don't stand there like you're stealing the falcon's talons. Lose honorably.
You did well, Mascari, the whip snake said. This time, I look forward to our next bout.
With a sullen bow, he turned on his heel and headed into the crowd.
Forgive me, Gigante said. I haven't had to train the cur to lose with grace. Now, Angelo, I understand you seek a sponsor. I could introduce you to...
Fabrice held up his hand.
I shall ask favor of sponsors when he is ready.
The men exchanged words, but Angelo scarcely heard.
Despite the conversation about his future, he resumed scanning the pedestrians meandering amongst street performers and food vendors.
He searched for her in eager anticipation, like a young boy expecting a panettone on Christmas morn. It wasn't long before he spotted his true love, Isabella Scalfini, the young wife of Renzo Scalfini, controlling partner of the largest timber collegantia in the Republic. She stood beneath the column of San Todaro, fanning herself, laughing with a friend. Isabella wore an intimately familiar sky-blue dress that accentuated her auburn hair and dark eyes. What her blonde friend wore, he noticed not.
"I believe I have found my sponsor," Angelo said. "Please excuse me, Signori."
After a bow to both men, Angelo continued his mission. A costumed marching band interrupted his path. Their drumming matched the excited beat of his heart. He allowed them to pass. Then, in rhythm to the music, he strolled over to Isabella.
"My ladies," he said to the women, taking a rare opportunity to converse with the 18-year-old beauty in flagrant view for all to see. "A most delightful afternoon for the grandest festa to be held in our most serene city."
Unable to look away, Angelo locked his gaze with Isabella's. Her almond-shaped eyes smiled upon seeing him. Her presence ensnared him. And he savored every moment of it.
"Congratulations on your victory. Signor Mascari, is it not?"
she asked, her olive skin brightening. The sweetness of her voice always sparked memories of delicacies Angelo's mother baked. Combined with the floral and cinnamon aroma emanating from Isabella's embroidered white leather gloves, his mouth watered.
"Grazie, signora," he replied. "We met at Signor Balbi's Christmas ball. Do you not remember?" "Clearly I do, otherwise I wouldn't have remembered your name. Perhaps you are the one who has forgotten?"
"I could never forget you, Signora Scalfini."
"I meant you have forgotten your manners, or are you generally in the custom of approaching noble ladies without our husbands present, or without so much as a gentleman by your side?"
Isabella widened her eyes as they landed on Angelo's neck. His hand instinctively went to the target of her gaze, the silver crucifix she'd given him some weeks prior. He hadn't removed it since. It must have slipped out during the duel. He tucked it back into his shirt. Her friend arched her eyebrows and snickered with disdain, oblivious to his silent conversation with Isabella.
"Signora, I..." Angelo started.
"Go easy on the rascal, Signora Scalfini," a voice said from behind them.
The three turned to find two men approaching. Angelo was already acquainted with I Fratelli Uccello, the bird brothers. With every meeting, more and more he wished their paths had never crossed, though had they not, he never would have met Isabella. The flaxen-haired Vito Uccello strode up to them. His sharp, eagle-like features and broad posture always posed a threatening presence. His smaller brother Ivan followed a step behind. With raven hair and a tight face, the man scowled at everything he saw. Beady eyes darted over Angelo as if stalking a mouse. Without a word, he knew what the bird brothers wanted. The black book they'd tasked Angelo to retrieve from Renzo and Isabella's bedroom. After 6 months, he was no closer. Well, he was closer, but hadn't the desire to complete the task.
"I'm sure Angelo has a strong reason for approaching unaccompanied ladies, and we can vouch for him,"
Vito continued.
"Indeed," Angelo said. "I was, in fact, looking for Signora Scalfini's husband."
"I believe he's speaking with the Minister of Finance," Isabella replied. "Ah, see," Ivan said to Isabella's friend, "no cause for concern."
Angelo stole a look at Isabella. She observed him a second longer than appropriate. That she was putting on a show prompted an audible sigh of relief.
Scenes of the previous day's activities reflected in her eyes, causing a hardness in his pantaloons he needed to quell with less arousing thoughts.
Vito took a long gulp from his wooden mug and burped. A rank cloud of regurgitated anchovies, garlic, and red wine wafted through the air. The two wavered from inebriation as Ivan took a swig from a bottle, then refilled his brother's mug. The brothers cured his potential embarrassment.
On such a day, Vito said, there is cause for celebration and gaiety, Ivan offered.
He brushed a lock of hair off the shoulder of Isabella's friend.
Guard yourself, sir, she said, shooing his hand away.
Ivan scowled, his tightened eyes seeming to bore into her skull.
She sidestepped closer to Isabella.
Come now, ladies, Vito said. It is a beautiful day, and a day for beauty and love, community and sharing, perhaps a day for sharing love?
Vito massaged Isabella's shoulder. She tensed and looked at Angelo. Fury sizzled within him. Vito surely meant to provoke a reaction. Angelo would be a fool to counter.
Perhaps you can both join us at the masquerade tonight.
Vito's hand slithered down Isabella's arm to her waist. Angelo gripped the hilt of his rapier with such hatred that his knuckles turned ashen white.
Remove your hand from Lady Scalfini, he said, lest you wish to lose it. Mind your place, Mascari,
Vito kept his palm on Isabella.
Mind yours, sir, Isabella said, squirming out of his hold. What did you say, woman?
Ah, there is my husband, she said, pointing to a man in his early 40s with a pockmarked face and a frame twice the size of Angelo's.
He limped toward them, tucking a large, thick envelope into his jerkin.
He's your friend, is he not?
Indeed, Vito said.
He and Ivan stepped back from the ladies. Vito's words were the last of the conversation Angelo heard. The thought of yet another man attempting to possess Isabella churned his stomach. He would abandon his career. He'd abandon everything, if it meant he and his love could live in peace. As the group turned toward Isabella's advancing husband, Angelo stole off into the crowd, nearly barreling over a boy wearing a red gondolier's hat with a white feather. 1. Present day. Nick O'Connor bumped into a young boy in a red hat with a white feather as Julia dragged him through a throng of people. On either side of the corridor stood rows of marble columns, each topped with a crystal orb. A faceless, naked old man used a paintbrush to splatter a column. It wasn't the man's decrepit body, but the claret-colored streaks he made on the marble that caused Nick to shudder. A rhythmic drumming pounded his ears.
Nick, come on! Not again, not now! His wife flicked her gaze back to him,
her emerald eyes imploring him with exasperated desperation. She plowed forward, weaving through the people, hauling him along, her honey blonde ponytail bobbing with their steps. Nick glanced at the boy to make sure he was okay. The kid was fine. And his feathered hat was gone, replaced with a red baseball cap. As Nick turned forward, the columns disintegrated into space. A busy train terminal, similar to a modern airport, appeared. He recalled where they were, Milan's central station, and where they were headed, the U.S. consulate. But he couldn't figure out why they were walking at such a brisk clip, nor why Julia was leading him like they were seconds from missing their train. Though the regression to Angelo had receded and his memory was fuzzy, he was certain they'd just got off a train. It was a 5-minute cab ride to the consulate, but it wasn't a life-threatening emergency. Or was it? Events of the previous days felt more nightmarish than nearly being killed by the whipsnake. Fragments of images lurked in his mind. The Palazzo Ducale, Carlo, Della Porta, Tintoretto, Paradise. Isabella. The pounding intensified in volume and tempo, like a drummer on an ancient galley, gearing up for ramming speed. Again, Nick checked behind him. A college kid, also in a rush, had a pair of headphones on. A thumping techno remix of I Am the Walrus emanated from them.
Relieved the intrusion came from modern technology, Nick unwound in the comfort that he and Julia were finally going home. Less than a day, and they'd be in their own bed. No turning back now. He wouldn't forget Venice anytime soon, or ever. But then he noticed the real reason why his wife was in such a hurry. 15 feet behind the college kid, two uniformed cops matched their pace. One locked eyes with him. The other spoke into his radio. "Please, Nick, snap out of it," Julia yelled. "We gotta move." A tidal wave of sickening emotions he couldn't begin to sort washed over him. Memories stampeded his brain. After escaping Venice under cover of darkness, they had spent the night in an inn on the mainland. They woke early and caught a train to Milan. Their goalpost was the consulate, where they'd apply for emergency passports, if not protection, before flying home. He assumed the cops were following them because Detective Fenella in Venice put an APB out. Rage boiled in his gut. The O'Connors were so close to their destination. Nick had enough of all the damn obstacles. He squeezed Julia's hand and matched her speed so she wasn't yanking on him anymore. She met his gaze and understood in a blink. Her husband was back. He let her lead, grateful she had taken charge. The exit sign came into focus, his newfound fluency in Italian helping out. 20 feet to the door, then a cab. They could sprint to the consulate and request amnesty. Julia skidded to a stop, holding him back. Two more policemen appeared at the exit, blocking their path. He pivoted around. The cops to their rear were nearly on them. A fifth officer approached from the side. Sprinting back to the platform and crossing the tracks was an option, but he didn't want to put Julia in any more danger. In their hesitation, the police were on them like a pack of dogs. "This is taking forever," Julia said, sitting in the plastic chair next to him. They sat on one side of a steel table in a small interrogation room in Caserma Garibaldi, the state police's main station in Milan. Though the building must have been a few hundred years old, the interior appeared to have been modernized recently. The tiny bare room felt fresh. His movie and TV-loving brain hoped for a one-way mirror on the wall, but security cameras in each ceiling corner did the job. "You sure you're okay?" "Yeah," he lied. He scratched the back of his sweaty neck. "It was just a quick one. I told you, the farther we get from Venice, the more I'm my old self." "I wish you were saying that in the American consulate." She had no idea how much he agreed. He'd never forgive himself for the ordeal he put her through. Even after the hardships, she was still his rock and his heart. Typically, her presence was a panacea. But not now. Bile bubbled in his throat and coated his tongue, leaving an acidic taste he couldn't lose. They showered that morning and bought new clothes before catching their train. Julia had swapped her dress and broken sandals for jeans, a tank top, and canvas sneakers. Nick had done the same, replacing his smelly, canal-soaked garb for jeans and a black t-shirt. Even with a shower and fresh fabric, Nick couldn't get comfortable. Bruises carpeted his body, and he needed to shift every 30 seconds. He couldn't seem to wash Venice or Isabella away. He had glimpsed himself in the reflection of the squad car window as they were transported to the police station. Lines wove their way through his forehead beneath his brown hair, and his dark eyes were a maze of red highways. A week of stubble taunted him with a reminder of a vacation that spiraled into a life-threatening nightmare. Through it all, Julia managed to retain her beauty. Everyone had always said he and Julia made a good-looking couple, especially when her fair skin contrasted with his darker features. But Nick felt like a feral dog next to her. Or, more accurately, a wounded elephant. At 6'0" and 195 pounds, he wasn't a huge man, but sitting in that chair was no easy task. Nick turned his mind back to their present situation, unsure why their looks, something he typically never cared about, popped into his head. It had been, what, 3 days since he was in a police station in Venice? Considering he'd previously only been in a police station once in his life, as a teenager he'd gotten caught smoking weed with his friends in the back of an unlocked van, 3 times in a week felt like a very bad omen. "Wow, deja vu," Nick said, settling into present-day reality. Fortunately, the driver of the van in Boston didn't press charges. Though the Milan police hadn't officially arrested him, he wasn't sure he'd be so lucky this time. Apparently, a French detective was on his way to question them. Julia slugged his already bruised shoulder.
Ow!
What was that for? He rubbed his arm. I hope that hurt.
What was that for? Are you serious? This better not be deja vu, you a-hole. Gonna tell me what the hell you did to get Interpol involved or what?
Nick fidgeted with his tungsten wedding band and adjusted in the narrow chair. Each position exacerbated his bruises. Finding it impossible to sit without pain, he resigned himself to physical discomfort and set out to analyze their situation. He'd been pondering Julia's question for the last half hour. Though the events in Venice weren't exactly guidebook-friendly, Interpol seemed over the top. He recounted the experience in his head. After hearing Isabella Scalfini's voice coming from Tintoretto's paradise in the Palazzo Ducale, Nick had a past-life regression to Angelo Mascari, a 16th-century swordsman who had an affair with Isabella. Along the way, he discovered the Ancient Order of the Seventh Son, a wealthy group of religious zealots who tapped a lost power from the Tangut Kingdom in Mongolia. The order discovered that every person has a single soul, which travels through seven consecutive lives. They also learned how to extract souls they deem evil and have sentenced thousands to paradise as a type of purgatory. Isabella was caught and imprisoned, but Angelo got away, which is why Nick existed in the flesh six lives later. Sure, Nick tried to bring down the order. Who wouldn't? They were the criminals. But Interpol? It's not like he was a spy. He couldn't figure out how the Milano police even found them since they didn't have their passports, paid cash for everything, and never used their real names. He still yearned to free Isabella, but given that they had narrowly escaped with their lives, it no longer seemed possible. Making it home with Julia was now his singular concern. They had five things to do to reach that elusive goal. Go to the consulate, get emergency passports, book tickets home to Boston, go to the airport, and step onto a damn plane. And now here they were, locked in an interrogation room. Despite Nick's ability to converse with the arresting officers in their native tongue, he insisted on an English-speaking officer for Julia's benefit. His wife was in the middle of this mess. She deserved to understand the discussion. The officer's response was astonishing as she led them to the small room.
Everyone in Interpol speaks English.
Nick wasn't surprised Interpol employees were required to speak English. He was amazed the International Police Organization was involved at all, let alone a detective. Nick racked his brain. He suspected Della Porta had his hand in their detainment, but the last time he saw the head of the order, the man was on the run himself, until Detective Fenella and the others caught up with him. No doubt Della Porta convinced the cops to turn the tables on Nick.
Babe, you know everything that happened, he said, turning to Julia. You were right there with me. I can't tell if you're joking, if you have present-day selective memory, or if your supposed regressions are rotting your brain. You abandoned me for 2 days.
Nick sunk into himself at her words and scratched the back of his neck. In his zeal to free Isabella and the thousands of other souls, and destroy the order in the process, he got caught up in the moment. Della Porta sought an ancient journal that Nick's past life was blackmailed into stealing. Isabella's husband had possession of the book, but when the affair turned to true love, Angelo stopped searching for it. That didn't stop Della Porta from kidnapping Julia to use her as leverage. Nick didn't want Julia involved at all, and it killed him that Della Porta's goons brought them both to a torture room in the palazzo. It was only because Isabella told him Della Porta committed murder that they were able to escape, along with Carlo's help, of course. The Venetian artist friend may have been the order's new painter, the man responsible for the souls in paradise, but they wouldn't have been alive without him.
I meant you heard what Della Porta said. The dude's a liar, but he told the truth about what happened to me. The regressions to Angelo are real.
Nick didn't bother lowering his volume. The cops probably knew everything anyway, since the order had its tentacles everywhere. He figured they left him and Julia in the same room to get some intel or confession out of him. That was their mistake. Nick hoped they were recording this.
First off, Julia said, also raising her volume, half the conversation in a damn torture room wasn't in English, so no, I didn't hear everything either of you said. Second, none of that explains why we're in a police station now. It hit Nick. He snapped his fingers. The Countess. What Countess? That's who this is about. It's gotta be Jules. I met her for like 5 minutes. She's Tintoretto's descendant. She wanted to free the souls too, and Della Porta friggin' killed her. And now he's trying to pin her murder on me. How are you saying that so calmly? She threw a side gander at the cameras. And loudly. Because I didn't kill her. Julia picked at her fingernails. She studied Nick's eyes before speaking in a hushed tone. Did you kill anyone? No. Nick clenched his jaw. He'd yet to tell her about Tintoretto. There was so much to unpack. Yes, he killed a man, but a man who should have died in 1594. Julia's eyebrow raised, scrutinizing him. Though it was barely a lie, he needed to keep the truth hidden. Nick covered his mouth and spoke in as low a whisper as he could. I wish you let me toss the Palazzo blueprint in the water. They could use it as evidence against me. How? Della Porta killed the Countess there. He bludgeoned her to death. His wife gasped and matched his volume. You witnessed a murder? No, Isabella told me. Julia's eyes darkened at the name. It's not like I had an affair with her. Physically, it was the truth, of course, but he couldn't deny the pang of guilt that shot through him. His wife swallowed and stared at the table. He took her hand, intertwining her fingers in his, thankful she let him. Warm shivers fluttered through him. She released a forced chuckle and spoke in her normal voice. Don't worry. I'm not jealous of a two-dimensional 400-something woman in a painting. Pissed at the whole situation, yes. Weirded out that you can speak Italian. Venetian. Well, both. Even weirder. But jealous? No. Nick shifted. His lower back begged him to lie down, even on the concrete floor. Though he was glad Julia wasn't jealous, it also bugged him that she questioned the reality of what he'd experienced. After all you've seen, honey, paintings don't speak. Yeah, except when they do. Nick shook his head and looked away. Julia pressed her other hand over their intertwined clasp. Like I said, I agree some unexplainable things happened, but you say all you've seen. What did I see? Nick turned back. Now it was his turn to be pissed. Carlo saw me speaking with her. He saw the whole damn painting come to life. Ask him if you don't believe me. A Venetian artist is your best friend now? No, but I'll admit when I'm wrong about a guy. So yeah, I do trust him, and you know him better than I do. You guys got pretty chummy. Don't even, Julia said, freeing her hands. Carlo was the only person I could turn to, the only person I knew, and he saved us. Yeah, because he knows exactly what happened. Julia chewed her bottom lip. It's not that I don't believe you. It's just that it's so hard for me to accept. Like you said, Carlo saw it. You saw it. I didn't. But I believe you and trust you. More than Carlo, for the record. A lifetime more. Nick crumpled his brow. How could she not accept what he'd been through? One day he'd convince her. But that time wasn't now. I just wish you'd left the you-know-what in the water. She patted her jeans on her thigh and winked. After they had frisked her, Nick allowed himself to breathe when they didn't find it. And if you get caught with it, he whispered, it's a blueprint for your arrest, too. Wow, not funny. Anyway, they haven't arrested you either. Yet. We don't even know if this is about the Countess. I didn't kill her, Jules. Julia squeezed his hand. I know. We need a lawyer. They want me arrested because they want me gone. Why? I think you know. You just haven't accepted it yet. The doorknob turned. A mid-40s man, at least 6'2", with a round face, light brown complexion, and prematurely graying wavy hair entered the room and closed the door. Despite his physique, he moved with an effortless glide. Clearly mixed race, Nick had no clue what the man's background was. He sat in the opposite chair without a sound, his light gray suit and pastel blue tie camouflaging him into the walls. He set a file on the table and steepled his fingers before speaking English with a nasally French yet remarkably soothing accent.
"I am Richard Lacasse, a detective with Interpol," he tapped the file. "You are Nick and Julia O'Connor, both 28, from Massachusetts. Monsieur O'Connor, you are a software architect at Fidelity Invest."
"You have my file," Nick said, not hiding his impatience. "Can I ask me what color my shirt is?" Knowing he and Julia had been so close to freedom felt like an unseen hand clenching the back of his neck. Lacasse remained emotionless.
"Inside this file is overwhelming evidence against you, monsieur."
"I didn't kill her," Nick blurted out. The detective perked an eyebrow over his sanguine, carob-colored eyes.
"Didn't kill who?"
"Countess Tintoretto. I don't even know her name."
"Nick," Julia said, squeezing his knee. "Let's hear him out. What evidence are you referring to, Detective Lacasse? My husband didn't commit any crimes."
Lacasse whistled through his teeth.
"We shall get to that in a moment. I'd like to discuss the Countess first. I presume you're referring to Faustina Baldessari, a Countess in title only, of course."
"Yeah. I did not kill her, and there's not a shred of evidence I did."
"And why would I think you killed her? Or anyone, for that matter?"
Nick jerked back in his seat. He wanted to kick himself. How could he have made such a dumb rookie move? Always let them speak first. Don't give them anything they don't ask for. "You tell me," Nick said. Lacasse resumed his tranquil confidence and authority.
"You're on vacation, oui?"
"We were."
"Have you contacted your friends or family in the last few days?"
"What does that have to do with anything?" Julia asked.
"If people haven't heard from you, they do not think you've been murdered, oui?"
Nick rubbed his temples. This guy was winning, and it felt like the game hadn't even started.
"Such is the case with the Countess," Lacasse continued. "I heard about her because of you and your actions, Monsieur O'Connor. Now, let's get to those actions."
"We'd like a lawyer," Julia said, "and we want to speak to someone at the U.S. Embassy."
"You're not under arrest," Lacasse replied.
"So, we can go?" Nick asked. Without answering, Lacasse opened the file and spread out a series of photographs on the table.
2. "Look at me when I talk to you, you sniveling worm," he shouted over the roar of the machines.
He drove the dirty shoe into the man's face with such force that tattered leather shattered his nose, spraying blood on both men, which caused his head to whip back, cracking against the iron printing press. Carlo Zuccaro's eyes snapped open. The dream was bizarre. Dreams never made sense to him, but a fight in a 1920s printing house? He chalked it up to a long-forgotten movie he'd seen at some point in his life. Though the visuals faded, the drone of the machines persisted in his head, much like the anguished cries from the souls in Paradiso. He hadn't been able to shake them. 1,000 voices screaming at him simultaneously. The shrill buzz hammered a part of his brain he'd never used.
"Hello?"
Carlo rolled his head to his left. The naked Asian girl next to him bulged her chestnut brown eyes as if she'd been waiting for a response for a year.
"And here I thought those light hazel buttes were attentive?"
she asked with a pronounced Australian accent.
"Scusa me, Julia."
The girl's eyes widened even more.
Who the fuck is Julia?"
Realizing his trespass, Carlo shimmied his thin frame onto his side to face her.
Jordan.
He tucked her hair behind her ear, exposing a bit of acne on her cheek. Stockier than Julia, with shorter hair, Jordan wasn't his type physically, but he couldn't deny their chemistry, especially in bed. He also found her fascinating, an Asian Australian of Chinese descent who didn't know a word of Chinese. Compared to his own heritage of Venice ad infinitum, people from less homogeneous places offered him a transient opportunity to see the world through different lenses. Perhaps that's why tourists and exchange students attracted him.
"I had a strange dream," he said.
"You're always strange, but that's what I like about you. Stranger than usual last night."
She ran a finger down his chest, which was as smooth as his stubble-free face.
"But in a good way, with a different energy."
Her finger continued its journey.
"How does an artist get abs like these?"
Her touch sent warm shivers through his body, but he wasn't in the mood for physical intimacy. He grabbed a pack of cigarettes from the nightstand and shook one out.
"Don't even think about lighting that disgusting thing in here," she said, removing her hand.
"It's my flat. It's my lungs."
Carlo lit the cigarette and slid off the bed to open a window. Sunlight streamed in, glistening off the chandelier above his bed. The hum of a lazy motor drifted by in the canal that abutted the rear of his loft. It was the first time in 3 days he'd slept more than an hour. He rubbed his tatted forearms. Between Jordan becoming the order's painter and his day job as a normal artist, his brain had been on overdrive. His schedule was also catching up with him. 5 paintings due for an upcoming group show weren't going to paint themselves. He glanced around the room for his mobile, then remembered it was charging in the kitchen.
"What time is it?"
Jordan checked her Apple Watch.
"Almost noon. I've been trying to get you up for a while."
"I need to work."
He hadn't touched a paintbrush since he was last in the Great Council Room, and suddenly felt motivated to start a new piece. A vision flashed in his head. A classical siren, layered on top of an abstracted mechanical boiler room, painted on metallic glass. Was the inspiration sparked by the dream? Could Jordan be his muse? It didn't matter. His acrylics beckoned him. Grabbing his wrist, she stopped him from going.
"That's not why I was trying to wake you."
"Then why?"
She grinned.
"Because I'm naked in your bed, Drongo."
"Drongo, is that supposed to be Italian?"
"It's Aussie slang, and it means dummy, you Drongo. Focus on the naked bit."
"I needed to paint something now."
"I have a 10-pager about Veronese due tomorrow, but you don't see me racing out of your flat to the uni, do you?"
"Because I promised to help you."
Carlo took a drag, then sat on the edge of his bed.
"There's more than one way people can help each other, mate."
She traced a long, French manicured fingernail around the compass tattoo on his left forearm, giving it goosebumps. Maybe physical intimacy wasn't such a bad idea after all. The corners of Carlo's mouth involuntarily tilted upward. She was right, of course. Plus, a little more inspiration couldn't hurt.
"You're not mad about the name?"
Laughing, she stole the cigarette from his fingers, took a puff, and quashed it in the ashtray on the nightstand. She threw the sheets off before pushing him down and climbing on top of him.
"If you root me like you rooted me last night, call me Hugh Michael Jackman for all I care."
Their lips met as she pressed her body into his. Though Carlo had only met Julia recently and was a big player in her and Nick's ordeal, that adventure seemed to magnify time. Was a week a month? A year? For how long did he know her intelligence, her morality, her passion? Were they truly first life souls? Would they meet again in another life? A grim reminder hit Carlo. As the Order's painter, he had one life, not 7 lives like everyone else. The present mattered more than anything. He buried his tongue into her neck. Her soft skin tasted of salt and lilacs. She arched her back with a moan and tangled her fingers in his thick, dark hair. He rolled over on top of her.
"Julia."
The girl beneath him, the exchange student from Sydney, jutted her head back.
"Seriously?"
Carlo mentally cursed himself. Why couldn't he get Julia out of his head?
"Jordan," he said firmly.
"Sorry,
Julia is an old artist I'm studying. Like dead old. She's dead.
Jordan giggled.
To call your rank liar is an insult to rank liars. If Julia's such a cherry, give her a call. Have her join us.
Carlo cocked his head. Jordan seemed serious. He gave it a brief thought, but realized it was yet another fantasy, as much a fantasy as giving Julia a single kiss on the lips. It was bad enough Julia was married to his friend. Plus, she and Nick were back in the States, and he'd never see them again. Compartmentalizing his swirling thoughts, Carlo gave Julia, Jordan, what she wanted. He enjoyed it, of course. She was a dynamo, like always, and a much-needed release for his pent-up stress. He verbally and mentally called her Jordan, and as they explored each other's bodies, an increasingly familiar energy surged through him. Each sense felt heightened, hyper-real. Colors were vivid. Jordan's floral bouquet caressed his nose. His strength swelled, too. Of all the times he'd been with a woman, including Jordan, he'd never considered himself the dominant one. But now he was in complete control. He steered their sex like an assertive dancer directing his partner. More than that, he had newly found potency to do whatever he pleased. If he wanted to dominate her physically, he could, and she wouldn't have a chance to resist. Of course, he'd never do such a thing, so he nuzzled her neck in an apology. Thoughts of the great council room zipped back to Carlo's mind, when the sun crystal's life force imbued his body with Tintoretto's power. At the time, he described it as an excess of life. As he melded with Jordan's body, he realized he was right. He just needed to figure out if he liked the sensation, and what he'd do with it. 3. A dozen cell phone shots of Nick's fight with Bernardo and Dante in the Palazzo Ducale, all from different angles. Nick hitting Dante's ear, with the protector crying out. Nick elbowing Bernardo. Nick breaking Dante's nose, blood splattering the man's close-cropped beard. Security camera footage of Nick sprinting from the Palazzo grounds. Other shots of Nick escaping the police station. For good measure, Lacasse pulled out an iPad and showed amateur videos, not only of the fight, but also of Nick climbing the chairs to touch paradise.
So much for cameras not being allowed in the great council room, Nick mumbled under his breath.
Examining the photos spread across the table, he had to admit, it didn't look good. At least he wasn't wanted for murder. All things considered, it could have been way worse.
One good thing about all the tourists in Venice, Lacasse said, is there's an image of everyone and everything. Every second of the day.
Nick scoffed. At least one thing is good for both of us.
What's that, monsieur?
Those cameras have selective memory.
Nick wasn't surprised not one photo was taken during the convocation, when he'd rained chaos down, started a fire, and fought multiple men. Of course, all that would have also shown Tintoretto and the Order's ceremony. The lack of photos didn't prove Lacasse was with the Order, but it did strengthen the suspicion in Nick's gut. Leaning forward, Julia pored over the photos, shuffling them around.
How is a skirmish and inappropriate behavior some massive international crime that gets Interpol involved? She asked.
Yeah, Nick said, smiling at his wife. Julia's innate sense of justice never failed to inject a rational, common-sense approach into any conflict. Can't I just pay a fine or something? Lacasse leaned back in his chair and intertwined his fingers on the table, as if resting his case.
The Doge's palace is not merely a museum.
His French accent and soothing diction were the inverse of Della Porta's abrasiveness.
It is an Italian landmark and a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Had you cooperated in Venice, this would have been a minor affair. But you fought in the building, fought the police, and attempted to flee the European Union. That is why I am here.
The police attacked me, Nick said, forcing himself to not pound the table. The guards at the palazzo tried to kill me. I have the ridiculous sword wound to prove it. He rolled up his sleeve and showed Lacasse the ugly, scabbing 5-inch cut. Lacasse cocked his head a bit and raised an eyebrow.
Why would you fight the police when reporting a crime?
Because,
Nick clammed up, realizing he had no proof. Julia was right. He needed a lawyer.
Because they're corrupt assholes, Julia said, her face reddening, her eyes pinched into a tight scowl. They fucking kidnapped me. When are we gonna get a lawyer?
Now definitely concerned, Lacasse appeared unsettled by this information.
What do you mean they kidnapped you?
Julia folded her arms and spoke in measured tones.
They told me they had information about Nick, and then brought me to Della Porta in a dungeon and tied me up. That's what I mean.
I presume you're referring to Salvatore della Porta, the museum director?
There better not be another, she said.
Lacasse spoke to Nick.
You accused him of killing Madame Baldessari.
Yeah, Nick said. He's the guy you should be interrogating. A slow, uneasy breath exited Lacasse's nose.
I am not saying I don't believe you, but these are all serious accusations. The police kidnapping you, a museum director committing murder. You must admit, even for Venice, it does sound rather fantastical, no?
It happened.
Julia leaned back and crossed her arms.
Do you have proof?
Nick exchanged a worried glance with his wife.
He combed his memories. With everything the Order had done, all their crimes, they didn't have a shred of evidence. And half the things they did were tied to events that were preposterous at best. As if any jury in the world would believe a painting came to life, or that a 500-year-old man had been alive up until a few days ago.
I have a witness, Julia said.
Do you?
The detective widened an eye.
And their name?
Nick squeezed Julia's leg before she answered. Though Lacasse seemed by the book, his demeanor, or perhaps line of questioning, didn't sit well with him. As if Lacasse knew more than he should have. He eyeballed the detective's face, but the man countered without altering his expression a hair. Whether he was legit or working with the Order, this guy was a pro. Nick needed to up his game.
We have multiple witnesses and plenty of proof, he said, but we want a lawyer.
And have you contacted the American Embassy? Julia asked.
We sent an email informing them of your transfer. You'll have the opportunity to contact a lawyer once in Venice.
Nick and Julia stared in quizzical silence at Lacasse.
Nick wasn't sure if he'd heard right,
and if he did, he couldn't put his finger on his internal reaction. Was it fear? Elation? Trepidation? Anxiety? All the above? Whatever the sensation, it had nothing to do with the police and everything to do with the Order. And more to the point, Isabella. He was reasonably sure Julia was thinking the same thing when she finally spoke in a barely audible whisper.
What?
Noticing her quivering hand, Nick took it and held it tight.
The crimes occurred in Venice, Lacasse spoke to Julia. You'll need to be returned there to process your arrest.
Excuse me.
Monsieur O'Connor, I mean, not you. You, madame, are not under arrest, and of course free to go. As a courtesy, you are welcome to accompany your husband to Venice.
Nick wasn't even looking at Lacasse. Seeing Julia's face redden more, Nick's wave of emotions was replaced with a whole new set. Sympathy. Empathy. Guilt. Protectiveness. And a rapidly rising pulse.
I can't go back to Venice, he said, his voice cracking.
It's not a choice, Monsieur O'Connor. And I assure you, your corporation will make it a much more pleasant trip.
But the consulate is here, Nick said.
That's irrelevant, and far too early in the process. As I mentioned, they've been informed of your transfer. We're leaving in 5 minutes. I'll give you time to say goodbye to your wife if she chooses to stay.
With that, Lacasse gathered his photos and file and left the room. Whether the transfer confirmed Lacasse was with the Order or it was just standard protocol didn't make a difference. Either way, Nick was going back to Venice. He shut his eyes for a moment, then turned to Julia.
Babe, I'm so...
She whipped her hands away.
Don't fucking even, Nick.
Tears welled in her eyes. Nick's moistened too. He tried to fight them but surrendered to it all. As they rolled down his cheeks, the flood released from Julia. She threw her arms around him. They're minor charges, he said. We'll get through this.
I know. We were so close. I just feel so far from home. And it's such a steep hill to get there, like we keep slipping down.
Babe, you're not. Like he said, you're not under arrest. She pulled back. Nick wiped her cheeks. She did the same for him.
Does it matter? Of course I'm coming with you.
You should go home. I want you to go home.
Who'll get your lawyer? Keep Della Porta away. Keep us both sane.
Nick couldn't help but offer a sad smile. He truly wanted her safe and happy, but he'd never convince her to go home. He hugged her again.
I'm so sorry. You should be.
The unmarked black BMW X3's tires massaged the cobblestones of the alley behind the police station garage before turning onto Milan's paved streets. Nick sat in the back behind Julia. To his left, Lacasse sat behind the driver, another plain-clothed officer whose name he wasn't told. Nick kneaded his shackled hands on his lap. He couldn't remember how it felt being cuffed as a teenager, but now the metal seemed unnecessarily tight and restrictive. The flip side was that this luxury cop car didn't have ripped seats or a stench of stale vomit.
How far is the airport? He asked Lacasse.
We are driving to Venice, Monsieur O'Connor. It's only 3 hours.
Patently unhappy with the situation, Julia cleared her throat with a vengeance and gazed out the window at a Gothic cathedral.
We haven't been in one of these in a while, Nick said to her, trying to lighten the mood.
A horrible situation?
She snapped her head at him. Nick shifted in his seat.
A car? I meant a car.
Uh-huh.
She turned her attention back to the city passing by. As they exited the old city center, the buildings became more contemporary and spread out, a dramatic contrast to tightly wound ancient Venice. He didn't blame Julia for being pissed. They'd made it so far, just a few minutes more and they would have been home free. Now they were being dragged back to the lion's den, by the lion's teeth. Still, despite their predicament, driving in a car through modern northern Italy brought him back to the present, the real world. And crucially, his old self. Maybe they'd get out of this. He was only accused of minor crimes, after all. Figuring he could use the 3 hours to his advantage, he spoke to Lacasse again.
What did the consulate say?
We have not heard back, monsieur,
the Interpol detective replied, scrolling through his phone.
Don't I have the right to be brought there?
Why would you have that right?
Because I'm an American citizen.
With an irritated exhale that betrayed his typically calm demeanor, Lacasse turned to Nick.
So you can commit a crime and not be charged here?
Well, I didn't commit a crime.
You've forgotten the photographs?
Nick shut himself up. Lacasse relaxed his countenance again and fixed his gaze on Nick, showing a softer side.
Monsieur O'Connor, you have only been charged at this point. You have not gone to trial. You have not been found guilty.
Good to know, Nick said, cracking a smile to hide his anxiety.
But when you are found guilty, at that point, our country's governments can discuss extradition.
You mean I'll be rotting in an Italian prison either way?
You're a smart man, Monsieur O'Connor.
Lacasse's accent seemed to intensify his smugness. The man's haughty grin nearly reached his ear as he went back to his phone. Julia discharged one of her now trademarked low, guttural growls. Nick's shoulders sagged.
How'd you find us anyway? He asked Lacasse.
The Interpol detective scoffed.
Come on, Nick said. Best case for you, I eat pasta behind bars for the rest of my life. Worst case, I get off and we fly back to America. What's the difference?
Still not looking up, Lacasse whistled through his teeth.
A 3 hour drive, right? Nick continued.
The 180 minutes, it takes 2 seconds to ask the question each time, that's roughly 5,000.
How do you think? Facial recognition technology.
Julia turned around to Nick, shaking her head with an indignant hoot. They didn't need to exchange a word. He knew exactly what she was thinking.
The whole situation was absurd. Not just the cops and the order, but everything. Talking to a painting, running for his life, Paganelli, Tintoretto. A remarkable stat hit him. In his life as Angelo, he'd been with Isabella, physically in her presence, for a total of less than 24 hours. They needed less than that to reach the consulate. He released an angry half-laugh, half-growl of his own. They never stood a chance. 4.
Open it.
Detective Fenella approached the bars that sealed Della Porta's corridor, her auburn hair brushing the front of her fitted yellow linen blazer, her posture and expression as sharp as a steel blade. A short uniformed guard marched in front of her. Behind them strode Della Porta's attorney, a 30-year-old woman in a plain black business suit, her brown hair tied into a tight bun. Several birthmarks dotted her face. From beneath her tortoise-shell glasses, her clinical eyes commanded the look of someone who expected they'd win from the get-go. Salvatore della Porta should have felt more pleased, but he'd been in the cell for nearly 3 days. 3 days too long. A series of formalities needed to be completed before he'd be released. He removed his rectangular Gucci eyeglasses and polished the lenses with his handkerchief. One task was already accomplished. His attorney had convinced Venice's Procuratore della Repubblica, the district attorney, a man he'd known for 12 years, that there wasn't enough evidence to press charges. Though half his age, Della Porta's attorney was one of the top criminal defense lawyers in northern Italy, and a member of the order. They'd strategized about going up the ladder with connections, starting with the mayor, but his attorney was confident they wouldn't need any string pulling. A barrage of counter-evidence would prove a raving lunatic's accusation that Della Porta murdered the Countess was not only unfounded, it was downright laughable. Not to mention, they'd yet to find a body. Della Porta returned the glasses to his Roman nose and used his hands as best he could to comb his salt-and-pepper hair. He tucked his tieless white shirt into his gray wool slacks and donned his suit jacket. He should have been overjoyed. He'd gotten away with murder. The murder of someone who needed to be removed. True, the Countess's death was hardly a crime. It was a necessary action to advance a higher purpose that would transform the world for the better. So then why wasn't he elated? Why did feelings of uncertainty percolate in his gut? Perhaps, he rationalized, he'd hoped her murder would be pinned on O'Connor. The district attorney had no choice but to drop the charges since, without a body, there was no evidence of a murder at all. At this point, she was just unreachable, not even missing, perhaps on her yacht. Alas, O'Connor couldn't be charged. Yet. As the guard inserted the key into his cell's barred door, Della Porta sat on the cot, watching, listening. The key turned and the mechanism opened.
A lock and key, Della Porta thought.
It was one of the most transformative inventions in history. Yet the genius had long been forgotten. This particular lock was from the 1960s, ancient by most security standards, relatively brand new in the 300-year-old building. The holding cell was dismal, but he survived his ordeal by thanking his lucky star he wasn't living in centuries past, when the pathetic bastards sentenced to the Pozzi in the bowels of the Palazzo Ducale lived in darkness, pissed and shat in a hole in the corner, and dined on a wedge of stale bread. The modern-day guard clasped the lever and opened the poorly oiled door. The loud creak was a fitting metaphor, an unquestionable announcement of Della Porta's return to freedom. He wouldn't be slinking out, just like he wouldn't be tiptoeing to the future that lay in store. Only when the door was fully open and the three waited for him did he rise from the cot. He smoothed his suit and bid arrivederci to his involuntary hotel room. Striding into the hallway, he didn't look anyone in the eye.
La casa, he asked.
Fenella knew the question was for her.
They're on their way now.
She fell in step behind him.
Excellent.
5.
Please,
La casa said, motioning for Nick to board the idling police boat at the quay. Nick wondered if all cops in Europe were this courteous or if he was getting special treatment. Despite the Frenchman's manners, he was coaxing Nick toward an undesirable fate that seemed more inevitable with every step. 100 yards away, Liberty Bridge connected mainland Italy with Venice and was symbolically the last sense of modernity before entering the city. It struck Nick as odd they wouldn't drive over and get as close to their destination as they could. He gazed back at the parking lot. He hadn't yearned to be behind the wheel of a car this much since he got his license on his 16th birthday. "We take a boat from here?" he asked.
"This way," Lacasse replied, gripping Nick's cuffed arm.
The driver gestured for Julia to walk ahead of him as he took up the rear, his hand resting on his sidearm. Seagulls squealed overhead. Nick's stomach lurched. He'd been cognizant of his mood, shifting rapidly between confidence and distress. Seeing the driver's gun and three officers waiting on the police boat, distress won the battle and the war. He turned back to Julia. It was in her eyes, too. Everything suddenly got real. And on top of being arrested, they were returning him to Venice. Though Nick retained his ability to speak Venetian and Italian, Angelo had been quiet since the flashback to the Festa della Senza. But now, with the skyline of Venice in full view across the lagoon, his former self eased his way into the front of his mind, not saying anything, but lurking, waiting, grinning. The 10-minute ride was choppier than expected on the high-speed police boat. It could have been the noise or the need to stifle bouts of nausea emanating from multiple sources, but Nick didn't say a word the entire trip. Neither did Julia. The boat pulled up to a large red brick building that rose from the water. If it wasn't for the docked police boats and Nick's ability to read the signs, he would have thought the building was a 1930s insane asylum, not the Venetian headquarters for the Carabinieri, Italy's state police. Lacasse led Nick onto the pier and toward the entrance. Julia followed, with the driver and three officers in tow. When they reached the door, the driver stopped Julia.
"No entry, signora," he said.
"What do you mean?" she asked.
"I'm sorry, madame," Lacasse replied, "but you're not permitted in this entry. It's for police and prisoners."
"Dove la dovaria andar?"
Nick blurted out in Venetian. His command of the language took everyone there by surprise, including Lacasse, who seemingly couldn't speak the dialect.
"Sorry," Nick said, switching to English. "Where's she supposed to go?"
"Why'd you even take me here?" A frantic timbre crept into Julia's voice.
"You came on your volition," Lacasse pointed around the corner. "The main entrance is on the street side."
"How am I supposed to speak to my husband?" Julia asked. "I need to get a lawyer."
"There's no shortage of them," Lacasse said.
He nudged Nick along.
"Let's go."
"It's okay, babe," Nick said, calling back. "Find Carlo. He'll help you get a lawyer. They'll know what to do." And as they pushed Nick through the door, the last thing he saw was his sweet, beautiful wife standing there, looking more lost than he'd ever seen another person look.
"Go to Carlo's," he yelled.
As had been the case for the last few days, Nick's desire to free Isabella had subsided. He wanted her and the others released from paradise, despite their alleged crimes. But he realized it was an unwinnable fight. After the torture room, Julia's safety and his future with her eclipsed everything else. They just needed to get on a plane. It seemed so simple, yet so increasingly difficult. Inside the station, the long concrete entryway had the impression of walking from an arena to a locker room. The corridor led to a gate, where a guard in a bulletproof booth processed new arrivals. As they relieved Nick of his few belongings, his wallet, watch, and beloved belt, the booth guard turned to his right and pressed a button which emitted a loud buzz. Nick's heart skipped a beat. His skin grew cold. The blood drained from his face. The guard hadn't opened the gate for his entry, but to discharge the last man he wanted to see, Salvatore della Porta, who strode out with an air of supreme confidence. Nick's shock segued to the realization that della Porta had been arrested, and that understanding led to a fury since the man was now being freed. Detective Fenella, whom he'd last seen chasing after della Porta from the Palazzo's torture room, guided him through the double gate. She noticed Nick and averted her eyes. Della Porta, on the other hand, grinned at Nick victoriously.
"You were right after all,"
Della Porta said. Nick didn't answer.
This wouldn't end well for one of us, Mr. O'Connor. Or should I say, Signor Angelo Mascari?
A tempest fueled within, a wrath generated by centuries of wrongdoing, culminating in a present-day heat.
Only after the surprise and anger of seeing his nemesis did Nick interpret the implication of Della Porta's release. The man was no longer a suspect in the Countess's murder.
Julia stared at the station's rear door for what seemed like an eternity, her numbed mind enveloped in the fog of disbelief. She worried Nick's sorrowful gaze would be the last image of him she'd see. And what about her? What would she do? All alone in another country, her husband arrested, with one friend in Venice, Carlo, whose allegiance was questionable at best. At worst, the artist was loyal to the very people responsible for their predicament. The rumble of a train entering the city drowned out nearby church bells. She stood at the door hoping this was all a mistake, a dream, perhaps, or even a sadistic practical joke. But when a cop came out for a smoke break, the man leered at her and perked his lips. Discomfort replaced her numbness. She closed her eyes briefly and shuddered her body to scatter her nerves. This was real. It was happening. She picked at her fingernails, then rubbed the rosemary tattoo on her inner left wrist, a memento she got when her grandma Rosemary died 3 years earlier. A red Vespa zoomed past her toward the bridge. Julia caught a glimpse of the driver, a girl about her age with long fiery hair blowing behind her like a dragon's tail. Clutching her for dear life, a guy about the same age closed his eyes, strands of hair whipping his face. Unbothered by the ride and unafraid of any danger, the girl barked out words in Italian, in full control of every aspect of the situation. Julia stared at the motorbike as the couple sped out of Venice. At first, she thought the image was a sign. But then she noticed a swarm of Vespas riding to and from the city. But it didn't matter. Seeing the redhead on the bike sparked a 180 in her thinking. Her life was her own, and she was in charge. She promised herself she would stop being the victim. With that, she headed to the front of the building to obtain the station's contact info and visiting rules. The brisk walk refreshed her and helped adjust her psychological state. It even felt strangely nice being back in Venice. Even on the outskirts, where cars were allowed, and despite the unimaginable circumstances she was in, she had to admit, she loved this city. With a clear head, she made a mental list. Find a new hotel. Call Carlo. Get the stuff she and Nick had left behind. Hire a good defense attorney. Call the consulate. Her brief confidence vanished. Shit. The order had taken her purse and cell phone. She had nothing other than a melted stick of lip balm in her front jeans pocket. 6. Driving a paintbrush into his inner ear canal seemed like a reasonably good idea. The soles screamed at Carlo in a deafening cacophony that sounded like a blend of a million cicadas, 10,000 fingernails on a blackboard, and a dozen cruise ship horns all amplified to 11 and all emanating within his head. Bits of Venetian, Italian, and Latin words snaked their way through the noise. Liar, child, traitor, pagan, justice. But he couldn't isolate their specific source in Paradiso. Unable to take the pain, he burst out of the otherwise empty Great Council Room, shut the door, and dashed 10 meters down the hall to an open window overlooking the courtyard. He sucked air in. As he distanced himself from the painting, the voices diminished. Watching the spattering of tourists in the courtyard below helped as well. This wing of the palazzo was still closed to the public due to the fire, so few visitors showed up with the main attraction inaccessible. He cracked his knuckles and caressed his arms. For the second time in as many days, Carlo had experienced the unbearable. As a pleasure seeker who questioned how people enjoyed S&M, Carlo avoided pain almost religiously. He had ventured into the room to confirm that what he'd heard the previous day was real. He had made it a meter before turning around.
Thank you for coming, Carlo.
He turned to find Bernardo strolling toward him, his buzz cut and bruiser face belying his soft eyes.
The left sleeve of his navy blue suit was fastened at the elbow in place of a missing arm.
"Shall we sit in the great council room?"
Carlo took three long strides, grabbed Bernardo's suit jacket collar, and slammed the powerfully built man against the wall. Though the protector was twice his mass, Carlo's anger propelled a strength that made him feel like he was pushing an empty body.
"Carlo!"
Bernardo unsuccessfully tried to knock his hands away. A surprising expression of genuine fear passed over the man's face. Though Carlo had his talents and attributes, physical size and strength had never been one of them.
Always thin and never a good athlete, he'd been on the losing end of the handful of fights he had in his life.
To be able to throw a man Bernardo's size against the wall, and to instill a sense of anxiety in him, fueled Carlo with power.
"Did you know?" Carlo spoke through gritted teeth. "Let me go. What's gotten into you?"
Carlo released his collar but jabbed a finger into his chest.
"Thank you," Bernardo said, straightening his jacket. "You're lucky I'm not as young as I used to be." "Damn it, Bernardo, did you know?" "Know what? What are you doing?" "The voices. Could Tintoretto hear them? Could he hear all of them? All at the same time?"
Bernardo glanced at the great council room.
"Tell me the truth,"
Carlo yelled, his veins pumping blood on overdrive. He'd always respected Bernardo, and though he was 20 years older, considered him a friend. He never suspected Bernardo had lied to him, but now, as memories flickered through his head, the idea that the man never fibbed seemed a childish whimsy.
"It's a complicated," Bernardo said.
"It's a yes or no answer."
"It's a yes and no answer."
"What the hell does that mean? You're giving me a worse headache than the souls."
"It means Tintoretto was 500 years old, nearly deaf, and probably said 50 words in the last 50 years. Yes, there was a rumor, lore even, he could hear the imprisoned, but nobody knew for sure. And we never suspected he heard them all at once. Though,"
Bernardo peered at the floor.
"Though what? Look at me."
Bernardo met his eyes.
"It may explain his ears." "What do you mean? You just said he was deaf." "Carlo, his ears were always bloody."
Gasping at the inference, Carlo shut his eyes and pictured the one night he saw Tintoretto. Even in the presence of a 500-year-old man, to say there were distractions was an understatement, but he'd never forget seeing the Renaissance master. His face appeared in Carlo's mind. Pink hair, presumably white and stained with blood, grew wild from scabbed ears. Was the man digging his own eardrums out? Or did that happen decades prior? After all, Tintoretto spoke to him directly and answered his questions. Perhaps he read lips, or perhaps he managed to control the voices, or at least tune them out.
"I am truly sorry," Bernardo said when Carlo opened his eyes. "About many things. I never wanted this to happen. That is to say, I did have faith in you to be the next painter, and always thought you were the best and most competent choice. I meant nobody intended for the transition to be so quick and
violent."
Carlo had never known the stoic protector to be at a loss for words. Bernardo nodded.
"You said nobody knew," Carlo said. "What about Salvatore? Did he know I'd be able to hear them all?"
"I believe his answer would be the same as mine. It seems impossible he'd know more."
"But Tintoretto could have told him, or it could have been mentioned in some book."
Bernardo didn't have an answer. Even if nobody in the present day knew the truth, Carlo felt betrayed by the situation. He'd been gifted a great power, only to discover after the fact that it came with a greater curse.
"So, ramming a paintbrush into my ear canal is a good idea," he said.
"A bit extreme, don't you think? Can you hear them now, away from Paradiso?"
"A little,"
Carlo paused, listening to the faint voices assaulting his head.
"It's a whisper from here, like angry wind. I think most of them have stopped yelling."
"Let's walk, then.
It's not why I summoned you here anyway."
Bernardo placed his one good hand on Carlo's back and guided him away. Carlo had always pitied his friend.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.